Good morning. It's nice to see you and hear you, so talkative. Let's stand if you are able and let's sing together.
Friends, indeed, you are welcome here. Greetings in the name and grace and peace of Jesus, our resurrected Christ. You may be seated. Welcome to worship and welcome to St. Paul's. We are a community that celebrates the worth, dignity, and gifts of all people as children of God. And I'm so grateful that you're here worshiping with us this morning. Happy Mother's Day. I know that for many, this is a day of great celebration and joy. And for some, this is a day that is a struggle because of strained relationships with a mother because of wanting to be a parent and not seeing that come to fruition for any number of reasons. And so, friends, on this day, I wish you joy and peace and pray that it is a blessing for you in the midst of all that is going on. A few announcements as we get started. First of all, if you would take a moment to register your attendance, I'd be grateful. There's a green notebook on the end of your row. You can tell us that you're here. It's a gift to know that. You can also share a prayer request. There's a piece of paper on there, and you can drop that in the offering plate when it comes by. And if you're worshiping online, you can see ways to do that as well. But we would love to know that you are worshiping with us. A couple of small group opportunities. We're continuing a conversation about social principles, and you're invited. 4 o'clock this afternoon, Pastor Eric is leading that downstairs. And then on Thursday, we're continuing with Pastor Eric and Pastor Marilyn, the conversation around Proverbs. That is in person and online over the lunch hour on Thursday, and we'd love to have you be a part of that. Next week, there is a lot of good stuff happening. So during the 9 a.m. service, we will be celebrating, recognizing, blessing our graduates from high school. If you know somebody that you would like to be included in that list, please let me know as soon as you can. Then during the Love Seek Serve Hour, we will have a general conference debrief. You'll get to hear from Jesse Lipp, a delegate there, about all that happened, and then we'll talk about what that means for us together as a congregation. We'll also be celebrating Pentecost and Native American Ministries Sunday, and we have a special treat during the 11 o'clock service. The little jazz mass will be presented by our choir, so I'm very excited about that. With that in mind, we will not have Kids Connection next week. We will have a children's time during service, and please feel free to bring the kids. We'll have the most fun ever. And then next Sunday at 4 p.m., we're having Next, which is our sort of opportunity for you to get further connected with the church. So if you have questions about St. Paul's, about who we are, about what we do, about next steps for you, how to get plugged in, how to get connected, questions about what membership looks like, I want to encourage you to come and be a part of that. Again, that's 4 o'clock next Sunday afternoon. If you can let me know you're coming, that's great. If not, we'll take you anyway. But that'll be downstairs, and I would love to have you be a part of that conversation. One last note, Pastor Eric's going to talk about Serve Week in a little bit, but Serve Week is coming up at the end of the month. We will start 2 weeks from today. So one note about worship on the 26th. We'll have one combined service at 10 a.m. So if you just want to come to lunch and to serve, you can show up at your usual time. Or you can join us at 10 a.m. For a combined worship. We will move immediately from that into lunch and into service projects here at the church. And so we would love to have you come and be a part of that. And then I want to say this about Serve Week. Throughout that week, during the day and the evenings, we have opportunities for you to connect with partners of ours in the community to serve those around us. Not only do I want you to participate, but I'd love for you to think about who you might invite to serve alongside you. Sometimes it's easier to invite a neighbor or friend to come be a part of serving food or serving at one of our partners than even to worship on Sunday. So this is a good opportunity to bring somebody along, and I'd invite you to consider who you might bring with you. So lots of good stuff happening in our life and our community. Today we kick off a new series called Everybody Welcome. Reflecting on what it means for us to be people who are hospitable and welcoming and find a place for all to be included. So I'm excited to begin that. As you're able, I want to invite you to stand and join together in our call to worship, which is on the screen. This is based on Luke 15. As a shepherd seeks a lost sheep, so God seeks and rescues and calls us home. Like a woman searches for a lost coin until it's found, so God rejoices over one person restored to wholeness. As a father receives a returning wayward son, so God welcomes us and lets the past be past. Ever-loving and all-inviting God, help us to make room for you and for others. For to welcome a stranger is to welcome you, and to receive you is to receive all your beloveds. Help us receive and welcome and invite one another with rejoicing. In the name of Jesus Christ and by the power of your Spirit. Amen. Let's sing together.
You Let us join together to affirm our faith. I believe in Almighty God, who guided the people. You may turn around if you'd like, and you can see the words on the back of the screen. Oh, now we're good. Now, either direction. I believe in God, Almighty God, who guided the people in exile and in Exodus, the God of Joseph in Egypt and Daniel in Babylon, the God of foreigners and immigrants. I believe in Jesus Christ, a displaced Galilean who was born away from his people and his home, who fled his country with his parents when his life was in danger, and returning to his own country, suffered the oppression of the tyrant Pontius Pilate, the servant of a foreign power, who then was persecuted, beaten, and finally tortured, accused and condemned to death unjustly. But on the third day, this scorned Jesus rose from the dead, not as a foreigner, but to offer us citizenship in heaven. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the eternal immigrant from God's kingdom among us, who speaks all languages, lives in all countries, and reunites all races. I believe that the church is the secure home for the foreigner and for all believers who constitute it, who speak the same language and have the same purpose. I believe that the communion of the saints begins when we accept the diversity of the saints. I believe in the forgiveness of sin, which makes us all equal, and in reconciliation, which identifies more than does race, language, or nationality. I believe that in the resurrection, God will unite us as one people in which all are distinct and all are alike at the same time. Beyond this world, I believe in life eternal, in which no one will be an immigrant or a stranger, but all will be members of one family and citizens of God's kingdom, which will never end. Amen.
May be seated. Each week, we take a moment to talk about one area of ministry that we're sharing together. Today, I want to share a real celebration with one of our mission partners and an opportunity for us to continue to participate as we get ready for Serve Week. And I have it here somewhere. Kansas Health Foundation has set the goal of being Kansas being first in the nation in health outcomes. Currently, we are 29th. And the CEO of Kansas Health Foundation recently said, if we're going to lead the nation in health, we can't just make healthy people healthier. We have to look at ways to address the inequities that lead to health disparities. That means connecting and partnering with the organizations closest to the communities, neighborhoods, and households where these disparities are most prevalent. So they picked 30 organizations across Kansas to participate with a major grant in this work. And one of those 30 was The Hub in Argentina. And so we want to celebrate that with them. We have people there every week with an after-school program, with Tuesday Market, giving hundreds and hundreds of hours. We give thousands of dollars a year. Probably not to the degree of the Kansas Health Foundation, but if you know how these things work, major grants come because there's already sustaining and consistent support of folks like us. So we are excited to get to partner with that. And see, our gifts get multiplied. We've been talking about multiplying gifts. Our gifts get multiplied in this kind of way. When we sort of start, we stoke the fire and get it going, and then others come alongside. So I wanted to celebrate that with all of you and offer it up as one. If you haven't gotten to know the Hub, this community center in Argentine and KCK, we have a great opportunity during Serve Week to do that. It was one of my, I shared this last week, one of my favorite parts of Serve Week last year was how little kids could come together and we were with dinner with neighbors and it was a great time. That's one of three meals happening during Serve Week this year. That's happening on Thursday night. No, that's happening on Wednesday night. Wednesday night, and we would love to see you all ages at the Hub, dinner and serving, great time together. Two other meals. Thursday night will be with Kansas Interfaith Action for their annual dinner. And then Sunday, as Pastor Kyle mentioned, we will, after our 10 a.m. combined worship service, share in lunch together as we serve around the church building. So I hope you'll be part of all three of those meals that week. And I'm just thankful to get to participate. Our giving and our prayers and all of our volunteering is a big part of encouraging and making the work of the Hub continue to grow. So thank you for that. And in our thanks, we get to now bring our tithes and offerings.
Thank you.
Good and gracious God, we thank you for this outpouring of blessing. May it be multiplied to glorify you even further. In the name of Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen. You may be seated. And I'd like to invite our children to join me for Kids Connection. Miss Sherry's at the back of the sanctuary, and we'll head downstairs. Kids through sixth grade are invited to join us.
Thank you.
You all are the lucky ones. You may not know this. You have a screen this morning because Jesse is a genius. First service had to read their music off of paper. There was no projector. You thought not having the affirmation of faith was problematic. I did panic in the middle of service, asked Jesse if we needed to print lyric sheets for this service, and they kindly said, you know, there's this thing called hymnals. They're already printed. And I thought, well, that would be interesting. Anyway, okay, sorry. Our scripture today, as you probably predicted for Mother's Day, comes from Revelation. From chapter 7, beginning in verse 9. After this I looked, and there was a great multitude that no one could count, from every nation, from all tribes and peoples and languages, standing before the throne and before the Lamb, robed in white, with palm branches in their hands. They cried out in a loud voice, saying, "Salvation belongs to our God, who is seated at the throne, and to the Lamb." And all the angels stood around the throne and around the elders and the four living creatures, and they fell on their faces before the throne, and they worshiped God, singing, "Amen, blessing and glory and wisdom and thanksgiving and honor and power and might be to God forever and ever. Amen." Then one of the elders addressed me, saying, "Who are these robed in white, and where have they come from?" I said to him, "Sir, you are the one that knows that." Then he said to me, "These are they who have come out of the great ordeal. They've washed their robes and made them white in the blood of the Lamb. For this reason, they are before the throne of God, and they worship him day and night within his temple. And the one who is seated on the throne will shelter them. They will hunger no more and thirst no more. The sun will not strike them, nor any scorching heat. For the Lamb at the center of the throne will be their shepherd, and he will guide them to the springs of the water of life, and God will wipe away every tear from their eyes." May God add blessing to our reading and understanding of these words. So today we begin a new series, Everybody Welcome, in which I'm inviting us to consider how it is that we live in order to make sure that people feel safe and included and invited in our midst. It is to say that this idea of welcoming and including and affirming all people is important enough that it is worth our reflection and our intention. And the stages and the principles that we'll talk about over the next few weeks, they are things that most certainly could apply to you in your personal and your individual life. But I primarily want us to think, at least on Sunday mornings, about what this looks like for us together as a congregation. What does it mean for us to declare and then actually live out that everybody is welcome? So I will tell you just one sort of caveat as we go into this, that when I think of this idea and this notion, I often think about it in terms of hosting people or of a party. In part, that's because that's a gift of mine. That's something that I enjoy doing. But I understand that some of you may be introverts. And so the many times that I refer to a party or hosting people, I just want to give you permission to insert quiet book club in that space. And all the same principles apply, but if you need to do that translation, by all means, please feel free. But we'll often use the idea, or I'll use the language of a party or hosting, because that's how it comes to me. So each of the next several weeks, we'll look at this idea of everybody being welcomed in various stages. And I want to kick off this morning by thinking about how it is that we prepare and get ready. Before we even talk to or interact with those who are coming, before we receive them, how is the pre-welcoming going? How is it that we do the welcoming before the welcoming, before the interaction? This whole notion of getting ready sometimes is a chore, but it has a lot of value, and it has a lot of value for a lot of reasons. And I want to think about a couple of functions that come in this sort of pre-welcome, this getting ready. The first thing that I think that this time does as we think about what happens before we can welcome everybody is that it clarifies our priorities. Now, I don't know about you, but I've never had people over to my house and had enough time to do all the things that I intended to do. Have you experienced this? And so what happens is that we get a time crunch right before the thing happens, and then we have to clarify our priorities. What is most important? We probably want to tidy up, pick the socks up off the floor so that we can sort of convey to folks that we do in this household at least do laundry sometimes. So that might be a priority. We want to declutter, perhaps because we want to project something that may or may not be reality. But oftentimes, one of the first things we do is sort of clean up because of what we want to sort of people to experience when they come in. When we do that, we tend to focus on the places that people will be. So Hope and I, in our last house, we had this little pantry that was behind the kitchen. The first floor of our house was very small, but this pantry was very large. I've already resigned myself to the fact that it's the biggest one I'll ever have in my life, because it used to be the laundry room. But the owners before us had put the washer and dryer downstairs and turned this whole room about 12 to 14 feet deep into a pantry, and we sort of continued that. So we had a nice little shelf where we put all of our appliances, and it was wonderful. And it was very organized, primarily thanks to my wife most of the time, except when people came over. When people came over, this organized pantry became a bastion of chaos, as 10 minutes before we expected the first person to show up, everything got thrown into there, and we guarded that door with our lives, because heaven forbid somebody see what it looked like in there. There could have been a screaming child, and we would have raised somebody and said, no, we'll get them. It's best for us and for you. You know what I'm saying? So we prioritize these things in order to create a space. But that is a much different experience than what was happening about a year ago right now, which is that at our old house, we were having an open house. We were putting it on the market. And when you begin to prioritize your time for that sort of event, it looks different. Because I never before had thought about how clean our master closet was. But all of a sudden, people were going to be in there. And so this sets our priorities. And this is my point. When we're talking about people coming into a place, when we're talking about everybody being welcome, we have to clarify what the priorities are and where they are. And then we have to organize our time according to that. The second thing that I think we need to do in this sort of preparation phase is to clarify our purpose. And these two ideas, clarifying priorities and purpose, are interrelated, but just like we never have enough time, in my experience, we never have enough energy to do all the things that we want to do. And so we have to pick what is important, and oftentimes what is important depends on what the purpose is that people are coming over for. If we're celebrating a birthday or a family gathering, that's different than having an open house. I'll give you another example. I often tell couples as they come to me and begin to plan their wedding that you will use as much time as you have to plan your wedding. If that's 2 months, then you will use those 2 months. If that's 2 years, my experience is that you will use all of that time. And when we scale it based on whatever your particular experience is, we then have to clarify, what's the purpose? What do you hope for? Of course, there is marriage, but what do you want to be represented in the ceremony and in the reception? And what do you want people to experience? And those things help clarify the purpose. And once we've done that, then we can prioritize what order things happen in and where the energy goes, and perhaps we can let go of things that are less important. And so these are two things that happen in this first stage, this pre-welcome, before we even interact with others, is that we clarify priorities and purpose. And so one of the things that we might say is that in this time period, before we're interacting with others, as we're thinking about what it means to welcome, we begin to set the stage, and our attention goes to what is most important and how we are going to set the table. I often think what happens in this time period sort of betrays our heart. And here's what I mean by that. If you are excited about the company that's coming over, you'll stay up all night and pore over every single detail and do so joyfully. Perhaps you have the experience of falling in love, and the first time that person was going to come over for dinner, you were more than willing to do everything necessary to get ready and to attend to all the details. Now, compare that to the experience of looking on your calendar at the beginning of the week and saying, why did I schedule my friends to come over? What part of me thought I was going to have enough time when we're all maxed out? My guess is that you've had this experience too, where not because of the company, but because of what's going on in your life, you feel like you just don't have energy to give. And what can happen in those moments is we just sort of phone it in. There's more laundry baskets filled with stuff in plain sight because that's all we can do. I think that betrays the heart, not about our relationship with that person, but rather about where we are within our psyche and within our being. And it tells a story about where we're at. A third example, maybe you've had an opportunity to host something that you knew was going to bring some tension, extended family not excluded. And my guess is that if you knew there was going to be tension or you had tension with somebody who was coming over, that it's possible for us to get so caught up in our anxiety and our concern that it sort of robs all the joy out of the preparation. And that sometimes we find ourselves becoming fixated on small little details that nobody else will notice. And all of those are proxies for us not to think about the anxiety of what's coming. All this to say that I think one of the reasons this season, this pre-welcoming work is important is because it tells about our heart. It clarifies our purpose, it clarifies our priorities, and it gives us a good check on where we're at in the midst of the world. And so all of this is important. But what's this look like for us as a church, particularly here at St. Paul's? I would lift up for you that I think there are a couple of things that help us do this work. These aren't things that I did. These are things that you all have done over years. The first thing that comes to mind when we talk about clarifying priorities is our welcome statement. For me, this says, this is what we focus on. This is who we intend to be. This is what it says in full. We, the people of St. Paul's United Methodist Church, believe that God's love is expansive and unconditional, and that through Christ, God calls us to love one another as God loves us. I want to pause there just a minute. What we could say is that we don't have the ability to be all things to all people. We know that. Even as a church, we can't meet all of the needs of all of the people in our community, even if we tried. And so it becomes necessary for us to clarify what it is that we will focus on, what it is that we are going to lift up as being most important. Just like time, we can't be all the things to all the people. And so with that sort of background of saying this is all based in God's unconditional love, it continues to say this. Because of God's love, we welcome all people, regardless of gender, race, age, culture, or religious heritage, ethnic background, sexual orientation, gender identity, gender expression, economic circumstances, family configuration, or difference of ability. We celebrate the worth, dignity, and gifts of every person as a child of God. So friends, this talks about who it is that we intend to be, what we're focused on. There are churches up the road and down the road that are focused on different things, and this is what we say we think is important. And this is a beautiful statement. And again, you all spent a long time living into and crafting this, and now we together get to try to live out of that and explain what that means. And I think it's important for us as a beginning place to recognize that this is how we are going to organize our time together. The subtext of this, of course, is that there are people who have been pushed to the margins or excluded from the church, and this church aims to be a place where those folks most especially can feel welcome. It's why going through the process of naming all those different groups or categories of people is important to say we know that sometimes folks have been excluded, and we want to be clear that we will include all to the best of our ability. That's about clarifying priorities. A second example, clarifying purpose. Where do we invest our energy? For us, I think that falls or is defined in our mission statement. The mission of St. Paul's United Methodist Church is to love God and all others unconditionally, to seek answers to our questions, and to serve God by serving others. Out of these three pillars grows our discipleship pathway, which again is in part about differentiation. Even if we say that all churches exist to make disciples, what we say is that this is how we make disciples. This is where we invest our energy. This is where we form people so that somebody, if they wanted to know what sort of activities happen at St. Paul's, if I went there, if I went to check it out, we would say these are the things that shape our life together. It's how we make decisions. It's how we grow. It's how we do life with one another. Now, friends, these are important documents. I think they're core places that we can look when we talk about setting the table, when we talk about the welcome that comes before the welcome. There's other places we could look. We could look at our professions of faith and our participation in the denomination. We could look at the various ways that we share core values and our history. And all of those are valuable because all of them together help us convey our story. And they help us tell people that they can find safety here. They help us live out our values and understand the call of God. They They create on-ramps. Each of these documents, I think, is about answering questions about how it is that we tell of who we are, about certain things that we agree to, at least in principle, about what things we want to share with the community around us, and how we help people know that they can be who they are when they're here. And friends, all of this work is holy work that you all have been a part of for varying degrees of time and degrees of participation. But this has grown out of what we agree to together. All of this matters. Even simple things, I think, like rainbows can make a difference. Now, I may be in a minority here, but I do think it's possible to go overboard with rainbows. But it doesn't mean that we shouldn't have any, and I'll tell you why. Some years ago, I was serving at another church that had a pretty good mix of progressives and conservatives, and if you would have asked anybody in that church, they would have said that everybody is welcome here. Well, it so happened that one day a sign showed up in front of the church that was a rainbow sign that said, "All are welcome." They didn't even get trustees' approval. Can you believe it? It took us a while, actually, to figure out who had done it, but it ended up staying out there, and it aggravated some people, and others thought it was great. And here's the deal. I didn't think much about it until people began to start showing up because of that sign. And I'm going to be honest with you, that surprised me, because I thought we were a congregation that had a reputation in our city for welcoming all people. I thought that people on both sides of the aisle and different theological persuasions were pretty committed to that, and I thought others knew that. But in about 6 months' time, I think we had between 6 and 8 families who came for the first time because they saw that silly sign on the street. And friends, all that is to say that I think that sometimes these small things that we can often overlook become lifelines, particularly for people who have been pushed to the margins and outside. So when we talk about this work, we're talking about good and holy work. And when we talk about this, I think it's best for us to begin with the end in mind. That's true if you're gathering family together or getting ready to plan a wedding or a graduation. It's also true if you're hosting friends that you haven't seen in years, or if we're talking together about who we are as a church. And it's this idea of beginning with the end in mind that drew me to Revelation. Excuse me, to Revelation. I choked over it. Now, the book of Revelation can seem overwhelming and downright weird. And if you were hosting a party for your favorite books of the Bible, which is a combination of the introvert and extrovert thing from earlier, then you might not invite this last book. But it's frequently been, weaponized and mischaracterized and mongered for fear, and it's generally been employed to produce a lot of anxiety in a lot of directions for a lot of reasons. And yet, buried in the midst of all of that, in this symbolic language, there are profound promises. There's deep reassurance, and there's some beautiful pictures for us, and most particularly for people in places or seasons of challenge. And today's reading is one of those places. If you want, you can close your eyes and imagine it for just a moment there before the throne of God, however it is that you imagine that to look. There is a great gathering, so vast and expansive that nobody could ever count it. And among the gathering, there are people from every time and every place, from every nation and every background, all there together, and they're waving their palm branches like our students did the week before Easter. And they're together in different dialects, in different accents, but one voice together across all this diversity. They cry out loudly, "Salvation belongs to God." Friends, can you see it? Let it be known that life and liberation come from God. While that may strike us as obvious wisdom, or at least as a self-apparent presumption of the scriptures, we might miss the significance of what this means to the original audience. See, at the time of writing, the followers of Jesus were a small, oppressed group that existed in the context of the Roman Empire. And in ancient Rome, the official line was that salvation belonged to Caesar. As one writer points out, the propaganda of the day claimed that rescue from danger and enjoyment of peace and well-being for the many all flowed from Rome. But the writer of Revelation sees through the pretension of this brutal rule of violence that underpins the message of supposed harmony. And so that's why in the author's vision, there is a great diverse multitude that declares that God's reign stands in stark contrast to the ways of empire. So if we are to be a church that begins with the end in mind and has this vision of the future and has this picture of the end and this confession, then we ought to begin acting like it right now. If we see that empire divides and demonizes and destroys, then we ought to aim to unify and sanctify and build up. If we recognize the subtle and not so subtle ways that our culture dehumanizes some, undervalues others, and discriminates against still more of our siblings, then it seems we ought to do our best how to start learning to live differently. Are we tracking here? If we boil all of this down, what it means is that when we say all are welcome and we celebrate that and value that and seek to be in relationship with all kinds of people, we ought to try our best to understand how to fully live into that. And when we do so, we ought to remember that it's good practice for the time yet to come. So we could spend all day on this text, but I want to highlight just one more thing. The writer of Revelation in chapter 7 tells us that this great multitude of those who are gathered have known affliction and struggle. They've come through ordeal and they've been made new. And the scripture specifically says that it is for this reason that they worship day and night, for they no longer hunger or thirst, nor are they scorched by the heat. And the one who they worship is their shepherd who guides them to the waters of life, and God will wipe away every tear from their eyes. Friends, this passage for me is beautiful, and as I was preparing this week, I was thinking about my grandmothers, both who have gone on to the church triumphant, who experienced a lot of pain in their final years, and what a good and beautiful image this must be for them. But more broadly than that, as a church, this calls us to redefine how we envision and experience success. It isn't about having the most honor or the most resources. It isn't about amassing the most number of followers or contacts or fans or friends. It isn't even about being protected from danger. None of that is promised. The gathered masses aren't there because they somehow maneuvered around all those things. They're there because they've washed their robe of the signs of struggle and suffering and grief. And they're on the other side of those challenges. So there wasn't a promise then that life would be clean and simple and straightforward and come with assured success by our own definitions and protection from the challenges of the world. Instead, friends, our faith often calls us to push back on those very narratives and to lean into the challenging and hard things. And it's in the confidence of all of this, not that we have smooth sailing, but that on the other side of the struggle, there is the making of all things new, that we persist. So again, let's boil it down. If we are to be who we think we are as a church, we ought to look different. Instead of loving ourselves and our own tribe, we prioritize God and neighbor. Instead of seeking after material things and self-gratification, we seek the wholeness that comes in relationship with others and with our Maker. Instead of serving our interests and advancing our priorities, we serve the vulnerable and the interests of the common good. And that is the vision that Revelation has for us. Our reading then suggests that those become the hallmarks for the people and the place that God is forming. And so those things inform who and how and why we welcome others. So we begin with the picture of the end, and we look to what is now, and we ask, how do we get from here to there? How is it that we set the table and arrange the room and tell the story and make the space and prepare ourselves for what we need to know now so that we can get there? Those are the questions that we ask as a people of faith. And all of this informs for us, friends, the welcoming before the welcoming, the preparation before the reception. So when we talk about this as a church, we do the things that we talk about in our welcoming statement. We do things like using the rainbow and wearing trans stickers and joining the reconciling movement, not because everybody here is totally comfortable with it, but because there are people beyond these walls for whom this is a lifeline. How else can we do this? We tell people that whatever your messiness is, whatever your family structure, whatever your background and your joy and your griefs and your doubts and your questions and your choices and the choices that were made for you and your hopes and your dreams and your failures and your exhaustion and your cynicism, that all of it is welcome. You can bring it with you. You don't have to check it at the door. How else do we live this out then? When we order our lives together and our time together and our energy, we do so around discipleship. We do that around the priorities of faith first, not as an afterthought. We act with the confidence that comes from the work of God in our midst and the humility that comes from knowing that we don't have all the answers. We see ourselves as a community of pilgrims hoping to grow and discern and uncover and to learn and discover together that we might better experience the promise here and now and what is yet to come. We listen to the community around us, discern the needs and questions and struggles, and we begin to let that inform our life together. We look for barriers that exist between those beyond the walls and what it is to be a part of this community, whether those barriers are physical, emotional, or language in any form. And then we talk about how we dismantle them and how we make room and how we create on-ramps and possibilities that others might see themselves in our midst. This is the good and important and holy work. And it all matters because words and statements and buildings and processes and budgets and visuals, all of them matter. It's why we celebrate that the United Methodist Church is finally a place where love can be love and all can mean all. Or at least that much of the structural barriers are gone. And one of the things that you all have taught me is that living into that will take time. It's why communities like this one matter now, because I've heard you all say that there is a lifelong gap between profession and practice, and that the most faithful thing to do is to acknowledge that and to commit to progress along the way. So I want to wrap up. But as we talk today about what it means to say to everybody, welcome in this place, the first step is to prepare and to get ready. So I've lifted up a few things this church is doing fantastic, but we're not perfect. So here's my challenge to you this week to think about these three questions. In what ways can St. Paul's be clearer about our welcome? In what ways do we need to grow in our understanding and our embrace? And what barriers still exist that we need to be intentional about dismantling? And friends, this is a question that each one of us has to answer because your unique perspective matters in this. Maybe it's our physical plant, our building, and our property. Maybe it's our digital presence. Maybe it's our words or our silence. But you can see things that I can't see, and your lens is one that I can't see through. But if we are truly to welcome everybody, then it's going to require everybody's participation. So friends, that is the invitation, that we would start this journey with the end in mind, that we would envision a possibility of a different kind of community, and then we would look at ourselves, at the ways we're preparing, at the priorities that we have, at how we commit our time and our energy and our resources, at how we create on-ramps, and that we would work together to break down barriers that all of us and all of those beyond these walls might know that here in this place, they are welcome and valued. So may it always be. Amen. As we continue in worship, I want to invite the bells back forward and want to invite you to take a few moments to light a candle at the front or the back, or to spend time in prayer and reflection to continue this conversation and perhaps to think about those questions and what they mean for you. Thank you.
Friends, will you join me in prayer? Living and all-loving God, we give you thanks. You're worthy of all our praise. We give you thanks that you are always reaching out in love. God, that you are the generous one. You are the welcoming one. God, we are here because you've pursued us and made room for us in your life. God, we thank you that you come and dwell among us. God, we thank you for this vision that we've gotten to get today of this beloved community that you're uniting around the throne in all our diversity and all our unity, and something that represents a peace and justice and a highest good that is different from what the world often offers and calls good. God, we want to live more into that vision. We want to broaden and widen and extend your table where all are welcome. God, we want to be more diverse, knowing that in our differences, as we come together, we can see more of who you are, ways that we can't see on our own. God, community and your spirit among us can teach us. And so, God, help us to appreciate the diversity that we bring, and God, open the way for more. Be in the midst of those conversations with people who come from different backgrounds than ourselves. So God, give us a fresh start as we begin again with this end in mind. God, thank you that you keep giving us this start and you keep reminding us of that vision, going before us to make it happen, that it's not all on us. But God, forgive us for the times when we have not made room. When we've not made room for you, when we've not made room for others, God, maybe because they're different, they worship in a different way than we do, they have different opinions, they come from different backgrounds. God, we pray for all those who have been made to feel marginalized, often hurt by the church. I pray that we could offer something different, that we could be something different, we do something different. And God, even as we acknowledge that we have failed to make room all the time, God, in the way that you have, we also give you thanks that you don't wait until we're perfect. You don't wait until we're perfect for you to come in, that you come into the midst of our mess. God, and we don't have to have the mess completely taken care of before we invite the guests over. But God, help us to take the next steps. Help us to know what mess we can tolerate and be authentic with one another, and what messes you would have us to prioritize cleaning up now, today. God, thank you for the holy mess that is our church. And we ask that you would continue to guide us. God, be with those who are hurting, who are grieving today. Be in the midst of bringing your peace in the midst of conflict, wherever it is found. Now, loving God, thank you. Thank you that we get to be a part of this. Thank you, God, today for mothers. God, we acknowledge again that this can be a challenging holiday for so many. God, we celebrate where you have been a good mother to us, and where we can see that embodied in women and people all around us. God, we also just bring to you the places that are hard. And I want to end by sharing this prayer from a friend, Wynn Collier. Women of grace, beauty, and immense courage, when you desire to nurture and create life, you embody for us the power and creative love of the Trinity, the God whose very being emanates life. And when you bring flesh and bone from your womb, you renew for us the holy truth that God, from the very beginning, that you, God, are the one who births all that is good and beautiful in our world. You show us what is true, and you pray over us with tear-drenched faith, and you point us toward the God who loves us. You help us articulate what God's spirit, what you're speaking into our hearts. And so women and mothers of all kinds, we thank you for the ways that you've been prophets of the living God. We lift up today those who ache for children you've lost or children you've yet to know, for those who know wounds and loss from your own mother or children or upbringing, for those in the thick of bone-wearying labor of loving children, for those who think you've been drained of every last ounce of energy, for those with regrets, for those who on behalf of your children or someone else's children wage war against some evil that would ravage them, for those who are loving, mothering, or blessing children who are not your biological children, for those extending hospitality to the new life in your belly or the strangers on your block, for all who need to know the powerful ways your love and nurture and prayers and tears and fears and anger and weariness and hope and laundry and meals and midnight watches and exasperation and laughter all participate in God's mysterious act of creating beautiful life. God, we thank you for these. We ask that you, God, who filled Mother Eve with life, who brought our Savior into the world with Mary's remarkable courage, God, would you fill all with your mercy and joy today? We pray it in Jesus' name. Amen. And we pray the prayer that Jesus taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Amen. Please stand where you are and greet somebody next to you as we get ready to sing our final song.
Friends, I realize that I forgot one announcement at the beginning. You've heard us talk about El Porvenir and that trip coming up. And I said last week we were coming up on like an actual hard deadline, but I mean it this time. Tomorrow's the last deadline. We did have some folks sign up last week. And if you would like to join us, we would like to know today. Today. So the Holy Spirit told me to say that. It might have been for you. All right, friends, as we go from this place, this song talks about what it is that we're focusing on through this series, that everybody would be welcome and included, that we would understand what it means to live and walk that as a church with the end in mind, understanding the kingdom that God is building and our invitation to participate in here and now. Go from grace, go in grace and go in peace, to invite others to experience that, to know that they are loved and valued, to know that God goes with and before you. Amen.
Forevermore, no place at the table to live with.